Hi students, today we're going to look at how to analyze dams. So here we have a definition of dam. A dam is constructed to store a large quantity of water, which is used for the purpose of irrigation and power generation. A dam may be of any cross section. So most times, like earlier said, the purpose of a dam is to store water. So, and it can be of any cross section. It's used to store liquid or water. So, generally, we use it to boost the volume of water for irrigation and power generation. And this dam can be of any cross section. So, here we have the popular or the common cross section. We have that of rectangular, we have trapezoidal dams having water face vertical, and trapezoidal dams having water face inclined. So you can also see here, it said a dam constructed with earth is called an earthen dam, whereas a dam constructed with cement, concrete, is called a gravity dam or a concrete dam. So let's move down to analysis. So for rectangular dams, we take a look at it. You can see it is rectangular because B is equal to the top width is equal to the bottom width. So this is the top width of the dam. This is overall height of the dam given by H, overall height. Then this is the height of water. As you can see from this diagram, you can see this is water spilling down from the dam. So this, it's spilling down through the spillway. So this is the downstream part of the dam. The upstream is in the other side of the dam. So let's go back to the diagram. Here you have, this is the water face, the area that is, or the side of the dam that is in contact with water. This one is, we call this the upstream. This side is the upstream, while this side is the downstream. So this upstream is where the water is coming from. This dam is acting as a barrier to stop this water or increase the volume. So normally we do have openings here, which will cause sluices, but it's not present in this diagram. Through the sluices, water is expected to flow down here. And that water can move or turn a turbine. That water also flows for agricultural or irrigational purpose. So here we can see the overall height of the dam from C to B. This is the top width, D, C. The bottom width is from this point. This is supposed to be A here. A to B is the bottom width. This is the overall height of, this is the height of the water, denoted by small h. And this water is supposed to act at one third of the height. That's why you see the maximum pressure is acting at h over 3. This is the weight of the dam. Is a gravity dam, so its stability depends on its weight. So you can see the arrow shows the weight of the dam. Then here we have, this is the pressure, the line of the pressure here. If we try to, this is the resultant of this force, this pressure force here, this pressure here, and then the weight. So the resultant of the weight and the pressure gives this R here. So if we try to resolve this force and this force, so completing this parallelogram, this is a parallelogram given by L and M. So we'll be able to do a lot of derivations. Well, this is the water pressure, the pressure distribution. You can see it, water pressure diagram. So let's go back to the dam. The width of the dam is B, which is this. the height I've already set, so you can see the height here. Then here you have rho is the specific weight of the dam masonry. So the concrete used in constructing the dam is denoted, its specific weight is rho, where h is the height of water. You can see it here from here to here. Then w, this w here is a specific weight of water. So water also has its own specific weight. So the weight of the dam per unit length is at any given length of this dam, because the dam here, what we are seeing here is the cross section. You can see from the main diagram here, the dam is very lengthy. So you can see the length can run in meters or even up to a kilometer or more than that. So what we are seeing here is the length from this point to this point. But in this diagram, we are looking at cutting, if we cut a cross section, view it from this side, we'll be able to see. So this is the cross section. So per unit length, it is given by because we have a rectangular dam, so we have this base times height give us the area. Then when we multiply by the density of the concrete or specific weight of the concrete, that will give us the weight of the dam per unit height. So this weight will act through the center of gravity. You can see the weight is the W here, which is given by this cross section B times the height times the concrete, the specific weight of concrete. And so it will act through the cross section. You can see where it's acting through the center of gravity, because this is the centroid of this shape. So it's acting through it. So here we said, we know that the intensity of water pressure will be zero at the water face and will increase by a straight line law, WH at the bottom. Yes, at this point, this will be the height of water. The intensity of water pressure will be zero at this height. That's why you see zero here, and it will continue to increase and will become maximum at the bottom. So water pressure is supposed to increase with depth. The more you go deeper, the more it is high. You can remember the submersible submarine that got imploded recently. So it was because of the depth at which the divers went to, or the people went to search for the Titanic. So the pressure of water was much, and that is why it destroyed the submersible. So it shows that at the surface of water, the pressure is low. But down, as you go down the bottom, or you move down with down, the depth of water is supposed to increase. So you can see the water pressure increases and it's maximum at the bottom. So here, the rate of increase is given by, you can see where we said it will increase by a straight line law of WH, which is the specific weight of water by height, the height of water. And the more you can see the specific weight of water is constant, but H will continue to increase, because the more the depth is increasing, the more the pressure will increase. Thus, the average intensity of water pressure on the face of the dam is given by WH over 2. So at any point, the average intensity, because you can see that when you want to get the average, we said at any point is WH. So the average of it will be 1 over 2 times WH, which is WH over 2. So the total pressure per unit length of the dam, what will now be the total pressure, will now be the height times the average intensity, because the average at any point is WH over 2. So while the total will be the overall depth times the intensity at any point, or the average intensity, which is, we multiply this H multiplies this H, we have WH squared over 2. So this is our second equation. This one is the first equation. So you've already seen the diagram. Take a look at it, study it critically. Then you can see, we also expect that the stress diagram will be maximum at this point, but we are coming to that. So here it says, unless mentioned otherwise, the specific weight of water is given by 9.8 kilonewton per meter cube. So sometimes you can also use, you don't only use water, sometimes you can use other liquid, you can store that liquid. As it says, sometimes the dam is subjected to two kinds of liquid, e.g. insoluble oil over water. In such a case, the pressure diagram will be zero at the top and will increase by straight line law of WH up to the depth of the oil. So this is similar to what we said before. So, but this is not what we should worry ourselves. This one, we shouldn't worry ourselves about this. So now the water pressure, it acts at a height of H over 3. You can see here the height of it. The maximum water pressure is at the centroid of this pressure diagram. At the centroid of a triangle, this is a triangle. Why this is a rectangle? So this pressure distribution, the centroid acts at H over 3. That's why we said maximum pressure thrust is at H over 3. So when you come here, you can see we said the water pressure acts at the height of H over 3 from the bottom of the dam. As we can see here, height of H over 3. Okay. So now, with P and W as adjacent side, completing the parallelogram. So you can see it's acting here. This is W, the weight of the met of the dam, while this is the resultant. So if we try to complete this parallelogram, because this force is coming here as a dotted line, we try to complete this parallelogram that is here. So what will be our, we are trying to get what is our R now. This is using Pythagoras theorem. This is the inclined side. This is the opposite. This is the adjacent. So the Pythagoras theorem said that the square of this longest side, which is the hypotenuse, is equal to the square of the opposite plus the square of the adjacent. So what we are trying to say here is that in this equation we have here, the square of R is equal to the square of P plus the square of W. So you can see where we have this P is acting here. So from here to here is P, which is the opposite. Then the adjacent here, which we have here, is LN. It's LN. So, and it's denoted by the W here. So we can say that the square of R square is equal to P square plus W square. So that is what we have here. R square is equal to P square plus W square. But if you want to remove the square on the R side, you have to put a square root over this. So you already know this, because if R square is equal to P square plus W square, then when you want to remove the square on the R side, you have to put square root here. So that way we have R is equal to P square root of P square plus W square, which is our equation 3. So here it says, let X be the horizontal distance between the center of gravity of the dam and the point through which the resultant R cut the base. So we are looking at our small x. It says, let X be the horizontal distance between the center of gravity of the dam. This is the center of gravity of the dam, and where R cut this. So we are talking about X is shaky. Let X be the horizontal distance between the center of gravity of the dam and where the resultant cut the base. So it means you're talking about JK. Okay. And the point through which the resultant cuts the base, that distance JK, like I said earlier, from similar triangle. So we're looking at a similar triangle here. You can see we have a similar triangle here. what is our similar triangle? We have L, N, M, and we also have L, J, K. So from the mathematics of similar triangle, you can see L, N, M is similar to L, J, K. Because this is a triangle from L, J, K. And L, N, M is also another smaller triangle. So you will see that with that, because of that, they are similar. So we can say that L, N, M is similar to L, J, K. So that is why you see here. From there, we can easily say that here we can see what we have here. JK is equal to over LJ is equal to NM over LN. How come? JK. This is our JK. This is JK over NM. JK is similar because you can see this is JK from here to here. It is similar because this is the base. This triangle LNM, the base is NM. This triangle LJK, the base is JK. So that's why you say JK is equal to, you know, is similar to NM over what we have here is LJ is also equal to LN. LJ, you can see it, LJ is equal to LN because this to this is similar to this to this. They are all the opposite side. So this opposite side of the bigger triangle is similar to opposite side of the smaller triangle LN. Okay, so that's why we have this equation here. So when we now substitute, what is our JK? Remember we said that JK is X denoted by X. That's what we are looking for. We don't know what it is. Now, we know that what is LJ? LJ is from this distance to this distance, and the same thing as H over 3. So we replace LJ with H over 3. We'll come back here and replace it with H over 3. And is equal to what is our NM? Let's go back. Our NM. You can see what is our NM. What do we use to replace our NM here? We'll come here. We have our NM. Here it says it's P. Is it P? Let's confirm. From here, NM, yes, it is P, because remember that today when we're completing the parallelogram, we said that this distance to this distance is P, while this distance to this distance is W. This distance to this distance, when we derive to this equation here. So this distance, which we completed earlier as a parallelogram, P, from here to here is P, from here to here is, this point is W. So we replace NM with P. That's why you see NM is replaced with P, and LN, which is this very one to here, is W. So we replace it with W. So when we cross multiply or make X the subject of formula, we have P over W times H over 3. This simply arithmetic. So this is equation 4. So here it says, let D prime or this X star or asterisk be the distance between the toe of the dam A and the point where the resultant cuts the base. Where's the toe of the dam? Remember today we said, I said DC is equal to, I said here is supposed to be AB. So we are talking about this distance to this distance. So if the distance here, that's what he's saying, he said, let this D asterisk be this distance here, this point, to this point. So we are going to find what is D now. And for us to find what is D, remember that we have, this is a centroid, which means if this is B, the distance between here to this point will be B over 2. Because this is B. So half of this is B over 2 from here to here. And we already know what this distance is, JK, is our X. So distance between this point will be B over 2 from here to here, then plus JK, which is X. So that's what we want to derive next. So that's why we have here, so D is equal to AJ. What is our AJ? This point is A to J plus JK. I see it's AJ plus JK and it's B over 2 plus X, as I told you, B over 2 from here to this point, which is half of the base, half of it, I see, then plus JK, which we got earlier as what, said our JK is what, X, you can see it here. So that's how we're able to derive AJ plus JK is B over 2 plus X. So if we go further to simplify that, we know what our AJ is, okay, B over 2 plus X. Now, what is our X? We pick everything here and replace it with X. That is how we're able to get B over 2 plus X. That is brack plus bracket, everything here, which is we're substituting for X here. Okay. So, and the eccentricity of the resultant, which is E, what is the eccentricity? What is the eccentricity of this resultant? So here you have, since there is a resultant here, we have to find its own its eccentricity. So here we have the eccentricity, which is D minus B over 2. Of course, since we have our D here, B over 2 is half of it. And we know that D is from this point to this point, which we got earlier. And see here where we got it. So since this distance from this distance to this distance is D from A to J to K, I beg your pardon, is from here to here is D, the eccentricity will now be this portion to this portion, because it will be the base, half of the base minus, or half of the width minus, there is the overall, which is D. We say D is A, K minus half of the width, which means the eccentricity is still the same thing with X, which you got earlier, or JK. So let's go back and see. So E is equal to D minus B over 2. Little consideration will show that as a result of the eccentricity, some moment will come into play, which will cause some bending stress at the base section of the dam. The magnitude of this moment. So, of course, when we talk about eccentricity, if the line of the force is acting at the center, you can see that here we can see because of this force that is acting here, because had it been it is only the weight of this acting through the centroid, this section will be balanced. But there is a water pressure acting here, which induces a resultant and also eccentricity, because any shift from the line of axis, the line of axis will induce moment, because whenever there is eccentricity is a distance, is always a horizontal distance. So, and we know that moment is the product of force and perpendicular distance. So it will induce moment at the base of the dam. So here we have this, where we said the magnitude of this moment will be equal to the weight of the dam times eccentricity. Remember, I said that, which is W times the eccentricity. Because eccentricity is something as D, which is AK minus JK. So minus b over b over 2, beg your pardon, ak minus b over 2, which is equal to jk. Okay, so here we have it, which is the weight of the dam times eccentricity, which is capital W dot E, which is the eccentricity. Now consider a unit length of the dam. We know that the moment of inertia of the base section about CG, we have it as what? We have it as BH cube, or you can say L B cube over 12. Yes, we are using L because the B, this is B, which is L is the longer side. And we know that the length, we're talking about a unit length. That's why we have 1 multiplied by B cube over 12 and is equal to B cube over 12. Now let y equal to distance between the center of gravity of the base section and the extreme fiber. That's b over 2. You say let y equal to the distance between the center of gravity of the base section and the extreme fiber of the base. So where we have b over 2 in this case. So that is half of the base, which is b over 2. Then, and let this, all we have here, delta b equal to bending stress in the fiber at a distance y from the center of gravity. Then we know that m over I is equal to delta b over y. This is equation of, this is a general equation of bending stress. If we want to get the bending stress from strength of material, so we make delta b the subject of formula by cross multiplying my over I. So when we now substitute, we have a moment already, which is we got earlier as w dot e. That's why we have w dot e times what is our y is half of the base, which is the width, which is b over 2. Then moment of inertia, which we have already, b cube over 12. We substitute. So substituting this, we have 6w dot e over b square, because one of these b will cancel one of these b here. So, and these two cancel from here. So that's why we're having 6w dot e. You solve it. But when you do this, solving this purely mathematics, you get this. So now the distribution of the direct stress at the base. The distribution of these, the direct stress at the base, that is what we're having here, because it will be minimum here and it will be maximum at this point. So this point is a dry or the downstream, the upstream is this side. So here we have distribution of the base, the direct stress at the base, weight of the dam is equal to the width of the dam. So the weight of the dam is W, the width of the dam is B. So if we have that, it means what we have. So now a little consideration will show that the stress across the base at B will be maximum, whereas the stress across the base at A will be minimum. So like we said earlier, this side will be minimum where you have the water, then the dry side is maximum. So we go back to that expression where we have this point, which is, this is the minimum plus the maximum. So delta max is delta zero plus delta B, and our delta zero is W plus over B plus delta B. Delta zero, you can see it, W over B, then plus delta B, which is this. So we're going to have W over B plus 6 dot 6W dot E over B squared, that's what we have here. Plus AW over B plus 6W dot E over B squared. So here we can easily collect like terms. So if you look at like terms, BW is common here and it's common B over W. The W over B is common here and it's common here. So if we bring it outside the bracket, what we mean here is 1, that's why we have 1 plus. Already we have taken W out here, we've taken 1B. So what we mean is 6 dot E over B. So that's what we have here. So for the minimum, it's still the same thing. The difference is just a sign. So that's still what we have here. So you can see with the condition that we have here. So we look at an example on this. So let us look at an example. Say water tank contains 1.3 meter deep water. Find the pressure exerted by the water by unit length of the tank. Take specific gravity of water as 9.8. So by unit length, pressure exerted we said is WH squared over 2. Remember we have this already here. This is WH squared over 2. So that's total pressure per unit length of the dam. So we substitute and we are able to substitute this as 9.8 times the height of water. We said the height is 1.3. That's why you see 1.3 squared over 2. But this is a simple example. Let's look at another example. Here it says find the magnitude and line of action of the pressure exerted on the side of a tank, which is 1.5 meter square and 1 meter deep. So if it is 1.5 meter square, it means the width is 1.5 and the overall height H, capital H, is 1 meter. The tank is filled half full of a liquid having specific gravity of 2, while the remainder is filled with a liquid having specific gravity of 1. So we're having liquid of 2 varying specific gravity. First one is having specific gravity of 1. This is 2. Remember they said at the height of water, they said that on the side, which is okay, and 1 meter deep, the tank is filled half the liquid having this. So this is 1 meter. The overall height of liquid is 1 meter, but 0.5 is of a different liquid. You can see this liquid is different from this liquid. So we have two pressure diagram. This one is from this first liquid. Then the second one is from the second liquid. Because if we look at this diagram, you will notice that we have an overall pressure. But why we are having this distribution to be different is because the specific gravities are different. The bin is water, it would have been a straight line water pressure distribution or triangle. So it's not going to be triangle because the liquid is having a lesser specific gravity, while this very one is having a specific gravity of 2. So here you can see the pressure. There's a pressure here which is P1 from this liquid, P2 from the second liquid. Then we have P3. So let us go here. So magnitude of the pressure is, although we don't need this for our analysis, but you can go through it. Let's take an example that will consign us. And I think this very one consigns us. Yes. Let's take this one, which is purely liquid. So here we have a concrete dam of rectangular section, 15 meter high and 6 meter wide, contains water up to a height of 13 meter. So you can see here, the width is 6 meters from the question, 6 meter wide. So 6 meter, overall height is 15. You see, the section is 15 meter high. So overall height is 15, while that water is, the height of water is 13. Then we already know automatically that the pressure will act at 13 over 3, say H over 3 earlier. Then here we are asked to find the total pressure per meter length of the dam. And remember we said is what WH squared over 2, the point where the resultant cut the base. We want to find which is D. We said remember to earlier we said this is given by D. And the maximum and minimum intensity of pressure as a mean of the weight of water and concrete as 10 and 25 kilonewton per meter cube respectively. So here, so given the height of the dam, we already have this, the weight of the dam, height of water 13, the weight of water, which is given to us as 10, and that of the concrete 25. So total pressure, said W squared over H of W, H squared over 2. So we substitute, you know, our W, which is this, as 10, you know, height, the height of water, smaller H is 13. I have it here, as 13, as 13. You can see it here, see it here, 13. So we substitute that over 2, and we have this. So point where it cuts the base. Remember that we have to get our W, we say this P, B times H, and we know what this rho here, sorry, this rho, this is not P. So rho is 25, you can see it here, multiplied by the base, the width, which is 6, then the height, overall height, which is 15, we have this. We have to establish this because remember we need to know our X first. Then when we know our X, we can now be able to get our D because X, D is X plus B over 2, as we said earlier. So the horizontal distance between the center of gravity of the dam section and the point where the resultant called the base JK, that's between here, talking about this point, JK, because AK is D. JK is X. So that's what we're looking for. Looking for X. So remember we had a relation ship today. Then we said P over W times H over 3. We have that today as X. Let's go back and remember where we had it. You can see it here. Here we have a P over W times H over 3. So we'll come back and substitute that. We have that here. Okay, so we already know what our W is as this. So P, what is our P? We got P, place it here, and place W times our small h is 13 over 3. We have 1.63 meters. So we have got the base, which is D now, is what we want to. We have gotten the X. So remember, we have also a derivation of the pressure at the base. This equation is what we use to solve for the last calculation or to conclude the calculation. So you can see here the maximum and minimum intensity of stress at the base. So the centricity is E, and E is equal to the same thing with X. Remember I said earlier that the centricity is always AK minus JK. So the centricity is between here to this point, which is JK, and the same thing as X. So we come back there and we have it as 1.63 from our early calculation here. I have it as 1.63 as X. So the maximum intensity of water pressure, remember with this equation, we substitute our W. You can see what our W is here. Substitute this value to 50. That's what we have over B. Our B is 6 meters right from time. You can see it here. Then in bracket, we have 1 plus 6. What is our E? 6 times 1.363 over B is 6. You have this. For the minimum, the same thing, the difference is just the sign. So you have this. So this is how to analyze a rectangular dam, a rectangular gravity dam. So if you have any question, you can ask after going through this video. So in the next video, we will look at that of a trapezoidal dam. We have trapezoidal dams with water face vertical, and we also have trapezoidal dam with water face inclined.